So, first question first. How is reliability different from DevOps? Well, one is an ability of a system, the other is an action. My ability to eat doesn't mean I'm going to eat. These are two different attributes. How does a system become reliable is what I'm just going to talk about. Few questions. Who is more reliable in all of these? Four. Fabio, Traffic, Kong. T-shirt dunga, haath khada karo. None? That's correct. Okay. Which one's more reliable of the four databases? I mean, there are four things, right? Like, so say something has to be better than the other one. Who's more reliable? Zookeeper, etcd, console, random con, anything? Last one? So, yeah. Anyway. So how do you define reliability actually? Like, does it mean that at some point your server, one server is online? Does it mean that all servers are below 100%? Does it mean all servers are responding within X milliseconds? Or does it mean all of the above? So these are important questions that we have to ask, you know, when we say that something is reliable or not. Because a lot of people get confused, like, you know, DevOps and SRE, what is the difference? Well, SRE job is to make sure that a system is reliable. It doesn't mean that it is reliable. As in, operations is something that you do on it. But the ability of a software in itself to be reliable is the question. So if I was to say an ideal software, right, is the one which does not require any human operations. You know, it keeps on running by itself. You know, when we say that it just works, imagine when you say the laptop is reliable, does it mean that it keeps working or does it mean that roz subah khol ke tel dal rahe hai, you know, something that you're doing with it. Right? I mean, that's what operations is. So if I have to look at a curve, the cost of the amount of operations that you do with a software has to eventually drop down. So it starts working, and that's where you would call it, yeah, this is a reliable system. You know, I don't have to spend time on this. It keeps working by itself. So to get there, let's just take a very sample application. A lot of people might have actually seen a talk of mine, but I've made some changes here. So if you've seen this on YouTube already, this is slightly different. So we're going to just take a very simple application. Remember the milk? User is going to send an SMS to a service. The service registers, this is the time at which I'm going to send back an SMS or call back, and will just remind you, like, hey, you asked me to remind you at Tuesday 9 p.m. buy the milk, so buy the milk. Fair enough, right? So I send an SMS which has some text on X date, remind me to do this. When the date and the time is right, the system calls you back on your phone. Very simple thing. Now, there are two aspects of this. One is the part where user sends an SMS and the service receives it. The other part is where we call the user back, right? We're going to make it further simple. What we say is, let's say we're going to use Twilio for this service. Now, while using Twilio, you receive an incoming webhook. The webhook records that this is where I have to call back the service, and it sends a response 200. A very simple arrow that goes in, goes out. We're going to focus so many ways by which these two arrows can now fill, right? Now, these are two systems. You know, Twilio is another service. My service is another system. You know, these are two distinct systems here. A very quick quote from Leslie Lamport, which says, distributed system is the one in which failure is a computer that you didn't even know existed, is going to bring your entire system unusable. Where is that system in here? The Dohi diagram, like, you know, now let's try to find out where that system is, you know, because this guy can't be wrong. Like, he's written so many research papers. So there is a system in the middle of these two flows, which we have to now find. Now, failures, what are failures? There's a CPU failure, there's a memory failure, there's a disk failure, there's a network failure. A CPU failure, well, it can't lie within these two systems, right? A memory failure is not within these two systems. A disk failure is not within these two systems. The only thing that can fail between these two systems is a network. Fair enough? So now let's look back at this picture. So there is something, there's some computer, which is going to fail, which is going to bring this entire system down just to prove Leslie Lamport right. Right? Now, who's more reliable? AWS, GCP, or Azure? So pick one. Let's start with differential analysis. Azure to nahi ho sakta. So, I mean, has to be some other two, right? So, But you can decide, right? See, I'm asking you these questions for a reason. Because a lot of people ask me, you know, tell me this is better or that is better. Like, which is better, Honda ka gaadi or Maruti ka car? You will not tell, right? There are dimensions to every problem. The goal is, by end of this talk, I want you to just understand what are the dimensions of a distributed system. You know, next time when you hear a fancy tool, well, Rockstar DB, well, Superstar DB, Popstar DB, you know, Cockroach DB, Insect DB, some DB, Philan DB, I want you to ask those questions. These are the dimensions on which I'm going to evaluate these. And if somebody is telling you all of these are better, he's lying, trust me, right? There have to be trade-offs. Computer science is all about trade-offs. We're just going to learn those. Let's say first system, well, failure point. Server is unavailable. What does an architecture diagram look like? Like this, there's nothing. Now, when there's a failover, right? I'm going to introduce one single concept at a time. There's a thing called VIP, a virtual IP. A virtual IP is basically where there are two systems who are trying to compete for an IP address. Because every service that you call, this is about networks, right? You go make a call, a socket talks to an IP address. The IP address, if one server fails, has to switch over to the other server. Now these two systems are going to compete with each other and try to acquire an IP address, but only one would get it at a time. And this is a concept of a VIP, age old concept, 1980s, 1970s, when the movie Terminator was made, the first one. Chorus saying, keep alive the heartbeat, you can use anything. But it's important that we remember this, you know, we learn this. Because a lot of people will tell me, you know, like, if you have to build a failover system, why don't you use a load balancer? I'll come to a load balancer as well. So in case there's a server A and there's a server B, one goes down, a VIP switches over to the other one, and that takes over the request, right? So we've got a system which is actually working in a failover. But a failover is not a load balance system, it's just a spare Stephanie. Right? You know, when the wheel goes down, you will pull out another one. What exactly does a load balance system look like? A load balance system has a server A, there is server B, requests are going to be divided. How? Equally, unfairly, fairly, we don't know, right? Now this is where we have to think about different schemes. These two words are very important, load and balance. How do you define load? Am I saying number of requests? Am I saying CPU usage? Am I saying latency? There has to be a definition. What's the best metric of load? Number of connections, CPU, memory, what? Or latency? We can't tell, right? That's the beauty of it, right? Because it depends on you. So if somebody tells you this is the best load metric, no, lying, again, right? You have to choose by yourself. Because each one has a different trade-off. I may go by number of connections, but it doesn't mean that the number of connections are being served at the same time. Byzantine failures is a word that we come up with, right? One server is running slower than the other server because there's degraded disk. Number of connections can be the answer. Is it CPU load? Well, I just said disk is failing. You know, so CPU load cannot be the answer as well. This is something that you have to figure out by yourself, by observing systems. By looking at them, you know, this is behaving this way, this is behaving that way. Now the question of balance. Now you have to choose to send a request to one system and to other system or to other system. How do you decide? Should I send two, one, two, two? What's the definition of two? Is it still going on or is it about the number of requests that have been served, right? Now, it's a pretty complicated problem. Now before I get to those, architecture of a load balancer. You know, next time when you use a load balancer, you have to think that a balancer itself can go down, right? When they give you an IP address, you will wonder that why does my server go down and not that load balancer? You know, like, how does that work? It does. It's just that the complexity is now encapsulated into that concept of a balancer. Now that balancer could be working in either of the two modes. It itself could be working in a distributed manner where there are two of them, or it could be working on a VIP-based principle, right? Now, when you look at the next time, when you look at a load balancer, and when you say that GCP only gives me one single IP address, do you want to take a guess which one is it using? The first one, right? Because they are using that topology. But when you look at AWS, when it gives you multiple IP addresses, it says the lower down one, right? But The IP address is for you to balance. The standard way to do that is by using a DNS query, right? When you attach a DNS name, you attach multiple IPs to it. It has offloaded the balancing part over to the user, over to you, and you decide, am I going to use AWS rooted weight policy? Am I going to use number of connections? Whatever, all those things that we talked about. Now, who uses what? GCP, fair to guess, right? It's the first one because they give you one single IP address, so there must be a VIP somewhere. AWS gives you multiple IP addresses, the one which is down below. Now, when they give you a multiple IP address, each IP address internally is a VIP because that can go down as well, right? It's layers of complexity, same constructs which are being used over and over again to make a cathedral or a bathroom. Now, what's a failover plus a load balance, right? Now, what's an ideal load on a distributed system? I should keep X percentage free. Any guess? Like 50% should be free? Well, it actually is. This one is slight mathematical. So yeah, we can take a stab at that. So what's the problem with the one which is down there? You know, like, let's say there are three servers and we are going to take 50% consumption, right? What's the problem? If every server is 50%, what is going to go wrong? Exactly. One zone goes dies. All the traffic is going to move to either of the two, and they're going to touch 100%. The moment they touch 100%, game over, right? Because you don't know how it's going to behave. Is it going to be OOM? Does it mean that memory starts swapping? Or you start getting degradations? Or CPU gets 100%? You don't know. Every of those failures is going to behave in a different way. So in a typical system, the threshold that you would accept is, well, somewhere around 40%. Because if one goes down, 40% reaches the other two nodes and it's still 80. You know, you can compute these numbers mathematically. Now, when you got a four node system, what you would say is, if one goes down, now this traffic should be distributed between the other two. Now this number will look somewhere around like 47%. Again, now you would say, why is only one going to go down? What if two goes down, right? Very fair question, two would go down. You're sleeping in the night, two zones go down. Well, rare event, but it depends on the complexity of your uptime. If you want a system which is like really, really uptime and you don't have people, well, either you pay people or you pay a server, right? So you would actually make it four zones. Now that can work as well, but you have to shell more money towards it. It depends on you. Now, if I was to ask you, which is more reliable, 3-rack system, 4-rack system, 5-rack system? 5 is the most reliable one, but it's not reliable on your pocket, right? So you got to make a guess there. Like, you know, how much failure can you adapt to? So next time when you say that, hey, US East has 5 zones, but Mumbai only has 3 zones, US East must be more stable. Well, I would say the other way around. Why did they need 5, right? Maybe that goes down more often. You know, but the answer is up to you. How much failover do you require? You know, most of these companies are based out of US East. So there's a stat here, funny fact, which is AppDynamics came up with a report and said that every time there is a zone that goes down for 5 minutes in US, each company loses $480,000. And you know, so it's up to you, like how much your failure can a business sustain? Now, reaches a trilemma. Which one should I choose? Should I make my system more endurable, more available, or more economical? Can I say that I want the best resilient system, but I don't want to pay money? No, it doesn't work that way. Well, so you got to pick either two of these three, right? The standard thing. Satta, sundar, tikao, do lo lo, teen nahi milte hai, right? Now, coming back to the same concept, load balancing. And what exactly is load balancing? We discussed, there are challenges to it, right? Now, if I was to pick up a most reliable algorithm here, which one's that? Is random better? Is round robin better? Is least frequently used better? Or is least connections better? Yeah, depends on? You know, that's the funny part. Yes, the answer depends was working on everybody or every other problem statement, but this one is not going to depend, you know. Let's take a sample problem, right? Let's say we flip a coin, head and tails, right? Our goal is to be fair, right? On a large proportion number, head and tails are going to be equal on a coin, right? Like, they show up almost the same amount of times. But if you take a window, and if this is going to be applied to operations that are happening in your window, heads and tails are going to be uneven when you look at it, right? Because at some, like if I take a small window, right? A head and even, head tail is even, right? For that period, you say that I'm going to take an algorithm which is random, is going to work. Now look at another chain, you know, what if you get a sequence of heads and those are number of requests? Now suddenly you realize that four requests go to one server, one request goes to the other server, right? So the actual answer to this is, if you pick up the random one, is the your best probability that on a large subset of system, your requests are going to be equal. If you're trying to maximize or optimize for a smaller window of operations, you just can't do that. Now, there's actually a very good talk by, I should have actually brought that earlier, by Tyler McKinnon. And it says that Fastly CTO, and they said that load balancing is almost impossible. Because, you know, like no matter what you do, any algorithm that you come up with, you just cannot be fair to a system. Because you're going to run into challenges of you decided to send 3-1 at one place, 3 at another place, but those 3 were the really bad requests. They were video encoding requests, right? Or you say that, oh, it's a video encoding request, they're going to be equal. Well, one video was 100 MBs, the other was 10 MBs, right? There are so many attributes that you can't decide on, so your best bet is just make it random. Coming back. Now, when we know what load is, we know how a load balancer works. Which of these techniques is actually the best technique? Should I use a client-side load balancer, a server-side load balancer, or a look-aside load balancer? Now, before I get there, I think it's important that we understand what these load balancing techniques are. Server-side load balancing is dead simple, right? Like everybody has been using an Nginx, Apache, or HA proxy at some point of time or the other, right? Or the fancy one, Kong, Traffic, and blah, blah, blah. Right? A request comes in, somebody decides for you that, hey, this is the best server that you should go to, please go there, job done. Now, look-aside load balancing. This is what a DNS does, right? When you hit a server, when you hit google.com, what IP do you get? Well, the random one, right? So a DNS server decided for you, not google.com servers, right? But a DNS server decided for you that, hey, this is the best IP that you should hit, what I think. Now this is look-aside load balancing, right? You're making a query between 50 IPs that it knows of Google, it will give you one IP and say that go hit this one. Now there are certain cases, there's a new one, which is client-side load balancing. Instead of somebody else making a decision for you, it gives you a series of IP addresses. You know, like go make your choice. Whatever algorithm you want to use, least frequently use, most frequently use, up to you. You know, do it the way you have to do it. Now, how does that work? Client-side load balancing. Now, this is where service discovery comes into the picture. You know, like most of the times when we say that, oh, we should use console, you know, best service mesh principle. While you're using Kubernetes, let's use Istio, et cetera, as well. Take a step back, how does it actually work? And why is it that way? You know, all these patterns, sidecar pattern, like whatever. So this service, there's an agent, client, which wants to call the service. Now there's a discovery layer in the middle. When a service comes up, it registers itself on the discovery machine and also gives a small health endpoint. You know, like call me on this and check whether I'm alive or not. So it adds itself. The discovery machine keeps pinging the service to see whether I'm alive, whether I'm not. Now, next time when a client wants to call that service, sorry, the first thing that it does is, it queries the DNS server, the discovery service, and says, give me all the IP addresses that are available. Now, it will only return the IP addresses that are healthy, because it's constantly doing a check for itself. So its only role is, now this might sound very similar to look-aside load balancing, right? But the difference here is, it's going to only do health checks for you, or may not. You know, like you may decide, I don't need health checks. It's a perennial service. You know, it doesn't go down ever. You have that confidence. So it gives you the series of IP addresses. Then it's up to you. When I say you, I mean the client code. Then it can choose, what am I going to use? So each client may decide to actually use the next one. Now, why is this important, right? Let's say you're building a mobile application. Now, while building this mobile application, you have to call a payment gateway. Now, if payment gateway gave you 3 IP addresses, and in your code, you are actually checking a if then else, what it allows you to do is, when you distribute this code out there, right, you're sitting in Bangalore, you're sitting in Delhi, you're sitting in Pune. Now, three of you are trying to make a payment. If there was a static algorithm for this, all of you are going to try to hit the same server or somebody else is going to do it. What if the edge network goes down? What if your ISP goes down, you know? Or what if that one IP is not reachable by you, but reachable by you, but the third one is not reachable by you? The fact that the decision is being done on the client side, they can actually adapt to it and hit the right server. Pretty advanced. You said that why do I need to add this complexity? Well, it depends on the uptime of your application. If it's a very sensitive application, you would want to do this. Now introduces another concept of load shedding. You know, this is one of the things that we don't realize. What load balancers are doing for you is if one of the systems is under too much stress, hey, wake up. So if one of the systems are under too much stress, what they do is they will cut off the load to that server and they will try to send the traffic to another server while it is waiting for those requests to complete. You know, exactly what used to happen in our 90s, every time we're watching a cricket match or a movie, there will be load shedding, electricity gone, right? Same concept, exactly the same one. Now, while it is doing all of this for you, we come back to the same conclusion, load balancing is almost impossible. So, because it is so impossible, you can't choose what load balancer is better than the other one. It's only a situation which may look like that this one is better than the other or your familiarity with it. Now, the first part has failed enough. Let's look at the second part, right? I'm going to call a user. How many ways can this fail? Now, let's look at the outbound call, right? Now, Twilio was calling me, and I'm going to call Twilio, right? Simple, just two arrows. Somewhere in my system, I would be going via a NAT address, which is the outbound of, does everybody understand NAT? Does anybody want me to explain NAT? Please raise your hand, it's all right. Okay, good, everybody gets it. Now, NAT is the route, outbound route, which is taken from your instance because it is not a public instance, so you still need to use something else for translation to send the traffic out. Now, NAT cannot make a DNS discovery of Twilio. What should I do? This is a very important question. Should my code just give up? Or what if you fail in your exam? Do you give up or do you retry? Retry, but how many times? Yeah. So retry, right? Like all of us have played Mario in our childhood, right? Like we don't get it once ever. Like, I mean, doesn't matter how many times you get there. It's a lie anyway. So has anybody completed Mario ever? Oh, cool, good. So yeah. Now retry, right? Now when a user sees a movie payment button and they say it's failing or Play Store app cannot download, they say retry, right? Now this once, they will retry once. Or you may retry multiple number of times, but my question would be, how do you know that if it hasn't worked once in 1 second, it will magically work in the next 5 seconds? Will you keep retrying forever? So what they say is, you know, like may take off an exponential back off. First retry after 1 second, second retry after 2 seconds, then three, then six, then eight, then 15, maybe it's one day it will work, right? But you can keep going on. Because what if it was a request, which was actually waiting? It's not an asynchronous architecture, right? So what do you do? So here's a term, very important one, called circuit breaking. You know what happens is, so most of, has anybody heard Hystrix? Hystrix, H-Y-S, okay, cool, good. Who hasn't heard Hystrix? Okay, cool. I think there was a guy who didn't raise a hand. So, I mean, it doesn't match up the total here. So, anyway, so, okay, maybe they know Hystrix, it's okay. So, what happens is that when you are about to make a connection, right? Let's say you're a service, I should not use Hotstar because there are people from Hotstar here. Let me use Netflix, there's nobody from Netflix, yeah. So you're watching Netflix, right? And they are trying to load content. For some reason, Akamai is down, right? Now, Hotstar guys know this, so the problem. Now, what happens is, if one guy is down, and you realize that Akamai is not working, another failure happens, three failures happen, four failures happen, it's not going to automatically work, right? You know, it happens. You know, earlier when it used to happen that, you know, on Slack, no, we used to do this, right? Like a lot of time when I was building these web services, I would realize that if a service resulted in an error, a user 500, it would result in a flurry of 500. My usual answer will be like, stop trying already. It's not going to work automatically. I'll have to fix this, right? So it's not going to work by itself, Akamai. Might as well, the next user who comes in and watches the video on Netflix, it gives you a chance to say that our services are facing a degradation. Rather than letting it for the user to go through that painful service of buffering, loading, and then something else has failed, where everybody is going to see this, don't do that, right? Break off the circuit. Akamai is down, I know this. Let's try back after 5 minutes. Now, this is a pattern called circuit breaking. Very important because it defines the usability of your application. Because it's living on a fact that if it didn't work once, it didn't work after a certain number of back off, give it some time, it's not going to happen by itself. So start using a different control mechanism, maybe through an error page or a good looking error page, you know, or alternatively watch this video stream instead. So who is more reliable? Retry once, keep retrying, or circuit breaking? Well, you don't know which was more reliable because, well, keep retrying. What if you deduct the balance multiple times? How do you know that? Now let's take a user example here, right? I'm calling Twilio to call a user, buy milk. But Twilio is failing to revert with an acknowledgement to me. And you say, keep retrying. He's gonna get a call 5 times, buy the milk, buy the milk, buy the milk. Like, fine, delete the app, right? You get my point, right? It defines user experience here. You can't say what is more important. You would say, if there was a magical way that we're going to only try it once, it will work. Right? Now this is where we fall into a trap, right? So again, I'm gonna ask, who's more reliable? At most once, now I'm gonna make it slightly mathematical here. At most once delivery, exactly once delivery, or at least once delivery? At least once, cool, let's look at least once. Tried, didn't work, failed. You didn't get a call. So it can be that, right? So because if you only try something once, let's take that board exam, right? You were in 10th, I failed it. So like if I would have not retried and only tried it once, I would have never got my graduation degree. So it doesn't work that way. You say at least once delivery, but does that mean that you keep trying forever and ever? Because you don't know what the outcome of that would be, right? Does it result in 100 calls being made to the user? Like, let's take a simple bug in an application. Twilio is failing to return with an acknowledgement to me that I have called the user. What should I do? Right? Pretty tough problem here. You know, like there's no simple answer for this. So what we say, okay, here's a thing. We go ahead. There are only 2 hard problems. Exactly once delivery, guaranteed order of messages, and exactly once delivery. Right. Cool? So let's solve this one. So, you know, the best is we said exactly once delivery. You know, like if there was a magical way that we said that, okay, we're going to do this thing only once, it's fine. You know, like deduct a balance. Should I keep retrying or should I only deduct it once? Once, right? Because all systems work on that. Now, it can only be done if there was at least once delivery and exactly once processing. What we mean by that is we got to try again and again, but the successful operation should only be done once. Now, it matters how we define success here, right? Now, this raises another question. What is successful? So, I'm going to try 100 times to explain this to you, but it should be explained only once, successfully, right? Now, key is, success is defined by idempotency. Even if I run this multiple times over, it should not matter. The output should remain exactly the same. Atomicity, right? Now, atomicity, everybody understand what atomicity is? It's like all of it either happens or it does not happen. You know, it's like a database transaction. You know, this has been age-old concept again, right? But just applied to distributed systems. I should either do it completely or just roll it back completely. Now, how do we implement this is up to us. And a window. Window is how long. Now, let's take an example. If Twilio, let's take a payment gateway, right? Here's a data, make a payment. This is a request payload, which has a request ID in it as well. This is one of the ways of achieving idempotency. You send a request ID, the other service receives this request ID. It sees, oh, I have actually sent a payment once. I'm not going to proceed further. Now, this is okay. This is good because I would say I'll keep it in somewhere, right? But in a payment system where billions of payments are happening, this hash is going to keep growing, right? Like if I have million requests an hour for payment, I will have million request IDs. Multiplied by 24 for a day, multiplied by 30 for a month, multiplied by 12 for a year, right? We're looking at almost petabyte of record. What that means is every subsequent idempotent operation is going to get more and more expensive, right? So system is naturally going to a degradation state. So it can't be that bad a design, right? Hence a window. Maintain idempotency only in a day or an hour, up to you, you know? If I see this request ID for the next 5 minutes, I'm not going to process it. But if you send it again, I'm going to process it again. It depends on that. Hence, these are the three key attributes of exactly once delivery. Because you have to design these constructs that way. Now, we don't care to pay attention to these things, you know, when we design systems. Now, I'm going to ask you a question here. If I was to revisit, this would look like, right? I have a request ID, I send it to Twilio. It processes it once, and then it calls a user, hoping that Twilio has some sort of request ID notion in it. If it doesn't, then well, good luck, keep trying. Which one's more reliable now? Kafka, Celery, RabbitMQ, or Sidekick with all these questions, you know? Like, does anybody believe here that if I just install one of these, my problem will be solved? It's okay, you can believe that right now. No? Okay, good, because these are just the tools that you need to get there, the problem behind it will exactly remain the same. Like Kafka is not going to automatically make a forever resilient system for you. Well, it has certain constructs, you should know how to use those. The window still has to be configured by you. It's a property of that system. So the next time when you run into the system, which is a queue, which is going to retry, I want you to ask this question. Does it have a window operation where I can set a window of retry? Does it have this notion of atomicity? Does it have this notion of, well, idempotency, right? And again, those are your consumers, not the queue processor. Example, if you are taking a message of Kafka and you are doing a bank transaction after that, but if you don't maintain idempotency on that end and somebody goes and rewinds that topic, ooh, game over, right? All the balance deducted 100 times over, right? So these are just the ways to get there, but you still have to understand the impact of those. You know, most of these things we realize after we have failed. Good would be if we could just, you know, understand these dimensions upfront. So takes me to another part. Guaranteed delivery in a multi-party system is almost impossible because there's so many people involved who have to care for idempotency. Now, I'm going to only focus on the middle layer, which is the storage. Which is data is stored, it has to be activated again. No network. Somebody said something? Yeah. Now, yeah, I'll get there. So there are two processes, var y equal to 1. One process does y equal to y plus 1, another does y equal to y into 2. What are the possible outcomes of this? Should it be 1, 2, or 3, or 4? Please raise your hand, we don't have too much time. Every time audience don't answer, you gotta stop that timer, right? So, right, the answer could be, it could be anything, right? Y, 1, y equal to y plus 1, the other one fails. So you got 2. Y equal to 1, y into 2, the first one fails. The answer is 2, both of them fail. Y remains 1, both of them happen. First one happens, multiply by 2 happens, right? So answer is 4, how about 3? 1 into 2 happens first, and then you add a 1 later. You know, all of these are possible states in a distributed system, and there's nothing wrong with it. They're all right states. It depends on how you serialize them. If there is a parallel operation happening between two states, they will compete. They will do by themselves. How do you control that? You say that I need a lock. When you say a lock, one thing is going to happen after the other. It's no longer parallel. But how does a lock still work? You know, one guy takes a log, read log, write log, semaphores, mutexes, we have studied all in college, who have gone to college, right, cool. So I'm going to skip this part. Now, master-master replication, right? One would say that, now, the point that I'm making here is, You try to save one thing into the database, and there's another operation trying to do something about it. Now, how do you control these two operations is what the challenge is. Do we say that one operation, now let's take the sample example. Cron is coming in and saying how many of these jobs are there which need to be called. Now, there'll be obviously, let's say, let's assume a best case, right? We have become a very big service. So many people are trying to depend on us. Now, I can't call those users one by one, you know? So obviously, I will have to do it, try to do it in parallel. When I do it in parallel, there are going to be multiple workers which are trying to feed off the same queue. How do I tell that queue? Take one, and the other queue I tell, don't take this one, because this one is already being processed by someone. So the same state is being referred to by multiple people here, multiple processes here. I try to give a human touch to processes, you know, like gives them a live nature. Yeah. Now, one would say, let's use a database, you know, which has master-master replication in it. Or the one says, you know, let's take a master-slave replication. Everybody understands these, or should I explain them? How is master-master and master-slave different? Cool, all good, all right. Now, one would say, well, these have, you know, they have limitation. Let's use something like, very fancy word out there, Paxos and Raft. Let's use that. Now, I'm going to come back to the same question. Who's more reliable? Master-master, master-slave, clustering, or eventually consistent? We run into these terminologies every single day, and we try to make a gun and say, you know, I've met so many people who say, hey, why don't you use Cassandra for this? It will solve your problem. Like, how does Cassandra know what I want? Right? I mean, I would love to if they would actually solve that problem for me. The challenges here are, a master-master means if one operation fails on one master node, it will not go to the other one as well. So the entire operation is going to fail. Master-slave means you're writing to one master. If a slave goes down, it won't get the record. And by the time it wakes up and the master goes down, those transactions are gone. You have to design an application where you are aware which one is a better choice for you. Eventually consistent. Something is reading from a slave. A master is eventually going to write there. It's possible that guy doesn't get it. It's okay, right? So again, these are challenges that you have to figure out in your system. Clustering, well, I just threw in a word in there because people just bring that word to me a lot. Now, raises me to cap theorem. Like, sab to bhi banate. So, talk me over here. Now, question here is, we have to keep an eye on this one, right? What we are saying is that we are going to throw three words here. Consistency, availability, and partitioning. Partitioning means if there is a network partition where two of your master-master or cluster can't speak with each other, how would a system behave? Well, it should keep running, right? Is that what our assumption is, or should it go down? Well, on the server side, two racks can't speak with each other. Should it bring the entire service down, or what should happen? We expect that it should continue to work, right? So let's keep this aside. Partitioning can never be an option. It has to be always partition resilient. Now, the only two parts left are consistency and availability. Does everybody understand cap theorem? It does? I'll skip through. Does everybody understand this one? Okay, cool. Yeah, this is just an extension of cap theorem, right? So we say that when we understand cap, it works this way. Now, in case of a partition, we're going to choose between availability and consistency. But when there is no partition, it says else, choose between latency and consistency. What that means is, either, you have to understand this, right? Now, data is either going to replicate right away, right? No, it doesn't work that way. There's network involved. We just discussed that. So data is eventually going to get to the other place, or it won't get to the other place, right? So pick between the two. Either say that I want my data guaranteed to be replicated on both sides, and if you do that, you can't have a fast operation, because it's taking time and the network may be slow. Now, or you say, I am okay with data getting acknowledged that I've written it, but it may not have reached the other place because the other operation that is going to read from the other service may not get it by that time, right? So you're gonna pick between these two. Now, if I look at a revised flow of our application, now this is what it's going to look like because we're trying to make it more reliable. One, Twilio sends it, I got multiple copies of balancers, have multiple service instances behind it. It does some magic to figure out those magics that we discussed, which obviously now we realize that, oh, service cannot just, there has to be a queue as well or some sort of database storage there because a cron is going to read from it. Now, when the cron reads from it, there are going to be some logs somewhere. There is some redis as well. There is some item potency notion. All of this is how you would design your application eventually. Now, you may omit these parts where you say, oh, this is too complicated. But at the same time, you have to understand, you are going to compromise that aspect of your reliability of your application. Now, I'll just take a minute more. So, now, a lot of people say, you know, you're lying. I've seen Google Cloud Spanner. Cloud Spanner does this all for me. Now, I've seen people say that to me, you know, like Cloud Spanner is both available and is consistent. No, they are just more available than your application. No, that is true, right? When you say that my application had 99% uptime, no, it had 99% of the uptime every time your monitoring node was trying to reach to it. It could have been sleeping in the middle, right? Now, when I was in my classroom, I was the most awake student, only every time when my teacher looked around, right? So, no, this is important to understand because the underlying hardware that Google is going to use is controlled by them, and your application runs on top of it. Their hardware is controlled by them, so it's just more available than yours. Don't try to read it. It's there on their blog, actually. Just write cap spanner and you'll get it. And the same goes for that other thing as well, Calvin, right? It's the exact same construct there. It's just more available than your application. And what they realize is that your application fails far more times than their network fails, so they just call them more available. But eventually, it's actually it's consistent. What they try to do is they try to replicate. And they also have the magic of the global timestamp, which we don't, because one of the other nodes is going to always fall behind a timestamp. So Google, what it does is it actually syncs it with geo satellites. So their timestamps are correct to the second, every single node, because they're connected to satellites. So answer being, absolute availability is almost impossible. You know, someone says that I'm 100% available, they're lying. They're just more available than their monitoring application. Now, a reliable system, how do we build that? The key aspects are, it has to be transparent. Transparency means that no matter what happens, the user is always oblivious to it. You know, like a DNS goes down, like your request goes routed to some other server, like google.com still works. Now, all of these are transparencies of properties, scalable, horizontally scalable, or vertically scalable. Your application, I mean, depends on your workload, how you're going about it. It's possible that you need more data storage now, so it goes vertical. You gotta go expand horizontal because now you're going in multiple geographies, it's up to you. And correctness. And summary being, if I was to actually ask to ever pick up a reliable system, you would only be able to pick two of those four attributes. And it's almost impossible to pick three as well, or let alone four. Now, you would say that my entire system is this? No, it's incorrect. Your multiple parts of the system may use multiple such constructs. Like while your database may only pick consistency and low latency, your other aspect of the system may decide to choose availability and economical. You know, it depends on you. Yeah, that's it. Thank you.